today. Thank you for showing up here. Have to admit, if I had a STEM program just when I was an undergraduate, maybe my path wouldn't have been so complex and difficult. So I think you guys are really fortunate to have this amazing program here. I'm going to start my talk with my ending slide. So this slide will be familiar because of a few reasons. If you remember anything from today's presentation, I have remembered these four things, regardless of what field you end up pursuing, but be passionate about what you do. You want to wake up and be excited about the job that you do. Ask lots of questions. I just had my 12-year-old's conference, and the biggest criticism he received from his teachers is that he asked too many questions, and I was beaming. My job, it would not be there if I didn't consistently ask questions. So really encourage you, whatever you do, don't ever stifle that part of you. Take chances. A lot of what I do sometimes is outside my comfort zone, whether it's going to the Antarctic, living on a ship for 2 months. I have to push myself and always tell myself, take chances, even if it's going to a new interview or something. And then also embrace change. I'm going to be talking about something that maybe you've never even heard about in terms of a field. Maybe you've come in here to know exactly what you want to do, but I would say be open-minded. There are probably jobs and majors out there that you haven't even heard of, and so really be open to those opportunities because they do not. And lastly, the majority of my talk, the science part of it, will be focused on deep-sea corals. And we are just sort of beginning to understand these complex ecosystems, and you'll learn more about them and why they're so difficult to study. But a lot of, I think, what we know about deep sea corals is going to be from young researchers and scientists that will conduct this kind of research in the future. So I hope you leave here with a lot more questions rather than answers, and maybe some questions that you hope to pursue in this field. So a little bit about myself. I grew up here on the peninsula, went to school in Louisiana, and studied geology there. I am a research oceanographer on a set, and I live with my husband, who was here last year giving a talk about sleep research. And here are my two kids and my two dogs, and of course, we love the oceans. So as I said, I went to undergraduate in Louisiana and wanted to get away from California as far as I could to do something different. And I didn't know what I wanted to study. So at the time, they assigned me an academic advisor, and he was a geology professor. He said, take my course. And I said, okay, sure, why not? I didn't know what I wanted to do. And I absolutely loved his course. It was both entertaining and just really opened my eyes to a new field that I did not know anything about. So I took one course, took the second course, the third course, and just found that it gave me basically new lenses to look at the world. I started looking at hills and rivers and valleys and whole landscapes through a completely different perspective. And for me, choosing geology really was the ability to blend my interest in the sciences as well as my passion for the outdoors. So for me, studying geology in Louisiana wasn't what I had thought it would be, and so I ended up transferring to Whitman College in Washington State. And I bring that up because some of you will end up transferring, and for me, transferring was a wonderful thing. It gave me opportunity to go somewhere new. I felt like I was a more focused and mature student, and it was a really easy transition for me. And so I finished at Whitman College and still didn't know what I wanted to do, even though I had this geology major. So I spent a year teaching outdoor science in the cold winters of Minnesota, and I really enjoyed that and thought, maybe I want to go to teaching, but still had this sort of pressing desire to find some answers to questions I had about what are the processes that occur on Earth and how are these landscapes formed. So I went to the University of New Hampshire, where I really wanted to study how glaciers shape the Earth. That was what I started to do, but then I realized that I had an opportunity to actually study the glaciers themselves. So I lived up into the Arctic for about 2 months on a glacier. So basically, a glacier is just a consolidated mass of ice that moves. And we see lots of landforms here in the United States that are formed by glaciers, and you all know that there are currently glaciers at the poles as well. So So what we did here in my research is we drilled into the glacier and we recovered these cores made out of ice. And these cores have layers in them. And these glaciers have been accumulating ice for thousands of years. So we can go back in time and analyze these different layers and say something about the atmosphere and the climate. So this is called paleoclimate research that I did using ice cores. And I really enjoyed this, got my master's, I thought, okay, I'm ready to decide what I want to do in the world. I still didn't know, I still had many questions, so I decided, well, I'll go teach English as a second language in Costa Rica. I really enjoyed that, but I also realized I was not fit for a classroom of 30, 10-year-olds. So I came back and decided to pursue a PhD here locally, and had enough of the cold season, and was lucky to work with a professor doing coral research. So. How many people here have snorkeled? Do we also have a few scuba divers in the crowd? Okay. So coral research, you can address it from many different avenues. My love is chemistry, so what I was doing is I was collecting cores in the same way that I was doing with ice cores, but in this case, I was drilling into these coral skeletons to remove a core. And this is an image of a coral core when we x-ray it, and it has banding, just like a tree. We can go back and we can count those bands, and we can make inferences about how climate and the environment has changed. So I definitely had a few twists and turns in terms of what my focus area is, and I finished my PhD, did some more training in Woods Hole, Massachusetts, and then decided to come back to California. And I've been working with the United States Geological Survey for about 8.5 years. So we have our main office in Menlo Park, some of you may have driven by it, but I work in the Santa Cruz office where we primarily do coastal and marine geology research. So I came in as a shallow coral expert, at least a relative expert, and that's what I thought I would be for the rest of my life. Well, I gave a talk back in headquarters on my shallow coral research, and there was a colleague there that said, you know what you're doing in the shallow world, let's apply it to the deep sea world. And I had never even heard of deep sea corals, but I thought, okay, well, let's give it a chance. And so that's really what my focus has been on the last few years, is deep sea corals. So again, I was passionate about what I do, but I was also open to doing something a little bit different. So that's really the focus of my talk today, is into the abyss, living without light. So a lot of you said you snorkel or you scuba dive. So you're going to take that world that you know, that shallow coral world, and you're going to go deeper and deeper and deeper without any light. And we're going to look at what is the deep sea coral ecosystem like. So this is one of my favorite images. I never get tired of looking at it. Whether you ask a 6-year-old or an 80-year-old, you'll probably get the same sort of sense of awe and the same perception of there's so much water on Earth. In fact, the oceans cover more than 70% of the Earth's surface of our planet, and 96% of the Earth's water can be found in our oceans. And it's also teeming with life. About 50 to 80% of all life on Earth is found under the ocean surface. You don't even have to get wet to see that light. If you've been out at Half Moon Bay, you can see the elephant seals or the otters in Monterey Bay. And the oceans contain tremendous amount of life below the surface. So I think some of you said you scuba dive or snorkel. So even if you just go a few inches below the ocean surface, you can start to see various types of life. And it really starts to pique your curiosity of what is down there? What's it like to live down there? But it's interesting, in terms of our curiosity, we really only began to sort of scratch the surface of what lives below the ocean surface. Part of this is logistics, right? It's really difficult to go out to sea and go down to depth. And the other reason that we sort of have only scratched the surface in terms of understanding life beneath the ocean surface is a belief system of what existed. So our earliest understanding of life beneath the ocean surface was when scientists or naturalists went out to sea and they would send down nets to collect organisms. And there was a scientist by the name of Edward Forbes And in the 1850s, he was out seagoing, doing scientific experiments, and he would cast this net, and he noticed that life became more impoverished and scarce the deeper and deeper that the nets would go. And so he came up with this theory called the azotic lifeless zone, saying that below 300 fathoms, which is about a quarter mile, that no life existed. And so he was quoted as saying, the mysterious dark depths of the seas is a barren, lifeless area. This was in about 1850, and it took about 30 years for this exotic theory to fall from grace when other naturalists followed up and were able to go deeper and actually prove that life did exist at deeper and deeper depths. So with advanced technology, we now know that there's tremendous ecosystems living in these deep, dark depths of the ocean. So we know, because of all of this advanced technology, that the average depth of the ocean is almost 4,000 meters. The deepest place is called the Marianas Trench, and from the bottom of the trench to the top of the surface is about 11 kilometers, and this is located near Guam. It became very famous when James Cameron took his deep sea submersible down there. Maybe you guys saw that in the newspapers or saw some coverage of that. So 90% of the volume of the ocean constitutes this dark, cold environment. It's the deep sea. And over half of the surface of the Earth is covered by water more than 1,000 meters deep. So spatially, it's really important, but we don't know a lot about it. A talk I gave last year, a little lady came up to me and gave me this handwritten card that said, we know more about the moon's behind than we do about the ocean's bottom. And it's true, we're just starting to learn about it. So let's take a quick look. I have a few videos of what life is like in the deep ocean. Below any, So you're in the aphotic zone. But what you didn't see from the video was that the temperatures are very cold and the pressure is extremely strong. That's the hydrostatic pressure. And so if you just look at a plot of temperature and pressure versus depth, you can see the temperature decreases and pressure increases as you go down with depth. I was talking to Aaron earlier and he was saying when he scuba dives, he gets a little bit of that ear problem. And so you've all experienced the hydrostatic pressure when you go down at depth. So this is easily demonstrated when I've gone with kids in their classrooms and they decorate these styrofoam cups and then I send them down to see, I send them down to depth and they come out really small because the styrofoam cup is probably 90% air. So that's a great demonstration. So needless to say, life in the deep sea is a really inhospitable environment. It's cold, it's dark, and there's intense pressures. And I like to joke around that that's why the anglerfish has such a grumpy look on his or her face. It's not a friendly place to live. So, but I'm going to take that perspective and turn it upside down by showing you another picture of what exists down at depth. This is sort of a conglomerate, but it demonstrates this extreme diversity of deep sea coral ecosystems. And some of these corals, as you'll see later, can live for decades or hundreds of years or thousands of years. And I have a few specimens up here, and if you're interested later, you can come take a look. But these deep sea corals look more like bushes or trees, right? These are the skeletons of the organism that the coral animal built. You knew that? So I like to think of these deep sea coral ecosystems as old growth forests that are under the sea. So let's just kind of go back to basics of what a coral is. What you see up here, if I were to say, rock, mineral, or animal, that game when you played as a kid, most of you would say rock. And it is. These are made of calcium carbonate. These are made of something called chitin, which is very much like the exoskeleton or like your fingernail. But this all begin with an animal building basically their house or their skeleton. And so the animal, the coral animal, is a polyp. On the left is the lophelia polyp, and it's all in the phylum Cnidarian. So I know some of you are biologist majors. And the cnidarians are also the sea anemones. So they have little tentacles. They stay in one place. They can't move around, but they extend their tentacles and they feed. So that's what the coral animal is. And that's where Nemo likes to live. So deep sea corals, they are found in cold oceanic waters worldwide. They can occur from near the surface, like in the fjords, but the water has to be cold. And they can extend it over 6,000 meters in depth. And they lack symbiotic algae. Again, if you walk away with one thing today, that's the key, is that these deep sea corals, they don't photosynthesize, they don't have the symbiotic relationship with algae. So they have to get their food that rains down from the surface. And they can live solitary or reef-like structures. This is a lophelia coral. It's made out of calcium carbonate, so just like the shallow corals that you see. And they form these big, big mounds. They're beautiful, and they're really important for fish habitat. They can form on shipwrecks. So a lot of times we go out to sea with anthropologists who are really excited when they see shipwrecks, and then we get excited because the corals have settled on the shipwrecks. And they can also form on oil rigs. So we work a lot with the oil and gas industry to try to understand this fine balance between resources and these ecosystems. So they can also live as solitary cup corals. So here you see the octopus, and they're living in these amazing environments on a canyon wall. If you look at a close-up of this coral, it looks like a flower. These are individual petals called septa. And in this case, it was recovered at depth and then rinsed, and so you don't see the tissue, but the tissue is then where the live coral polyp animal is living. And then you can get deep sea corals like this one. There's a sea anemone, but this is called a paragorgia. The nickname is bubblegum deep sea coral. And I think what's fascinating is that these corals have such brilliant, beautiful colors, and they're living in complete darkness. So I'm baffled about what's the benefit of these colors. I feel like Mother Nature does things for a reason, but I don't know this. So if you're thinking of a research question to pursue, I would encourage that. So where do we get our specimens from? Originally, we got a lot of our specimens sort of opportunistically through dredging processes. Basically what they do, it's a fishing practice. It's actually, unfortunately, still practiced today and is trying to be banned by the UN, but you drag a metal door along the bottom of the ocean. And you can also see, decades later, you can see these dredge scars on the bottom of the ocean. So it's really, really destructive. But I would say up until the 70s, that's where most of our specimens came from. And then we get a lot of specimens, unfortunately, from bycatch. So again, from deep sea fishing practices, maybe not with dredgers, but large nets that end up getting specimens. And so sometimes we'll get a specimen, we don't really know the location because the fishermen don't want to, you know, share that information with us, but we opportunistically, you know, take advantage of these. Now, to really make sure that we're doing our collections systematically and with minimal harm to the rest of the ecosystem, we really try to target our sampling, and we can do this because of technology. So one of the first things we do is we go out and we have to map the ocean floor. And the reason is we're looking for hard substrate, anything hard that the corals can settle on and start to build. Have a video. So this is called a multi-beam sonar. It was developed for military purposes, and basically, like any kind of sonar, like a bat, it sends out a sound from the transmitter, and it measures the time that it takes that sound to go down to the ocean floor and back up. And then you can create we'll color code them, these maps of the ocean floor. And that's a large part of what our group does over in the Santa Cruz office. And the reason I'm interested in these maps is because it helps us identify where these hard substrates are. And so here, for example, is Paragorgia living on these volcanic rocks in the deep sea. And again, they can live on human-produced forms, so oil rigs, shipwrecks, but any kind of hard substrate. So once we've done the mapping, then we can use, again, advanced technologies to go out and make really targeted sampling. And we do this, again, through advanced technologies using submersibles. And I mentioned that submersibles kind of became a household word with James Cameron's expedition with the Deep Sea Challenge down to Mariana's Trench. And this obviously was a very, very expensive endeavor and wasn't necessarily designed for scientific research, but really, I think, brought in, you know, to the kitchen that there's a world beneath the ocean surface. We use other types of submersibles. The one up here is called an AUV, an automated underwater vehicle. We work a lot with engineers in designing these, and basically you can program them. They're equipped with many, many sensors, and that you can go out and tell it to run a certain course and to map it and to take salinity and temperature measurements and oxygen measurements. And then the other kind of instrument that I work a lot with are called ROVs. So this is a remotely operated vehicle. So there's nobody inside this, but up on the ship, there's a whole room of, video game expert teenage boys, now adults and girls, wanting to use the joysticks to manipulate this instrument, the ROV. So it's not a game, but I would say if you like video games, you might have some of those skill sets to run this kind of instrument. So basically, it's sent down at depth, and we control it with a joystick, and it has manipulator arms to take samples, and it's pretty exciting because it can spend, you know, up to 36 hours down beneath the ocean surface, and these ships are, again, really advanced technology, and they can stay in one place, and that's really important because when the seas are moving around and this ROV is basically connected through an umbilical cord, you know, it has to be able to stay in one position and be able to control the ROV. So it takes a lot of work. It's not a single person endeavor. We have to work with a whole crew, engineers, the pilots, the whole ship's crew. And I have a little video showing kind of what's involved. Okay.
ship is unique in numerous ways from other ships that I've been on. RMV is a remotely operated vehicle. It's tethered to the ship.
Coming up on the RV.
It can move underwater, it has video camera capabilities, so it's essentially a robot underwater that pilots control on the ship side.
Yeah, Andrew, I'd love to get a zoom on the solitary hydroid there at some point.
Okay.
Coming up soon.
My name is Andrea Quattrini. I'm a PhD student at Temple University. I study deep sea coral ecosystems.
And now it's loaded for
I'm a ship-based science team lead. My role is to communicate and coordinate with scientists onshore, as well as the ROV team, to make sure that ROV operations go smoothly and science objectives are met.
I'd also like to know, where is this rock coming from? I don't know where down the 18th, so it must be something coming that rolls downhill. But I'm really wondering what this rock is made of. Are we looking at continental type crust here, or are we looking at something else?
The telepresence component here is definitely a unique experience. Scientists back on shore are listening in and communicating with us in real time as the ROV is exploring the bottom of the seafloor. Also, it allows the public and the viewers to see in real time what we're observing and to explore the dive with us.
We are currently at a depth of 1,875 meters.
Here in the control room, this is where all the action happens.
For any new listeners joining us, we are off of the northeast U.S. coast in the canyon system. We are on a lower continental slope. We're off the coast in waters off of New Jersey on Coron Island.
Our ROV pilots are manipulating and maneuvering the ROV, and the scientists sit in the back and help plan and lead ROV dives from a science perspective.
So we have about an hour left in the dive, so we'll start moving back up slope and then heading toward the top of the feature.
We really hope to characterize and discover new habitats, including deep sea coral communities, potential cold sea habitats or chemosynthetic communities. And we also are exploring geological features pertaining to landslide areas along the continental slope.
Even though this may have been in place quite a while ago, there's still active processes going on, even if the smaller boulder scale.
We're going to hopefully see several deepwater coral communities. Deepwater corals are, many of them are long-lived and slow-growing, and thus they're susceptible or vulnerable to anthropogenic disturbances. We also could see chemosynthetic communities, and these communities are found in cold sea areas. They house unique and individual communities from other areas of the deep sea floor. Both of these are types of biological hotspots, so you get high biodiversity of animals in these areas compared to other fauna that you see on the surrounding seafloor.
Copy that. Yeah, we can go ahead and bring serious support. Pilot, Dexter.
Dexter.
If we can secure power.
Copy that.
So you may have heard Andrea, who's a colleague of mine, mention something called telepresence. That's a big move in our community to engage the rest of the world in what we're doing. And so NOAA has a research ship out there called the Okeanos. And what they do is they have a few scientists on board, and then they have some of us back home called scientists on duty, and we can log in to their video and see where they're diving. And then they also have school groups and teachers, and anyone can actually go to their website and see where they're diving now. It's pretty fun. If you want to check it out, I can email Aaron or something some of these links. But it's a neat way to sort of engage yourself in this active research. The other interesting thing is when they're out diving, they'll have another ROV right above the bigger ROV. And it can actually help the other ROV know where it's going. It's called situational awareness. And I guess I bring that up because not only are there scientists involved, but there's a huge technology and engineering component that we really depend on. So you saw a lot of corals, you saw other animals, and then there's a whole group of folks who we call the mud god and goddesses, because these are the benthic ecologists who are really interested in what's living right at that interface between the water and what I call the sediment, basically the seafloor. And so we don't subsample that necessarily with the ROV, but we send down an instrument to take cores or boxes of mud. And what's really neat is the last ship that I was on, I think he was the bosun, so he was one of the ship's crew, and he loved taking video and making artwork. And I just wanted to share this little video project that he put together. So he was really interested in the science and wanted to, you know, share this of what happens when you do a box core. So this was the sketch that he made. He's a really good artist. This is the box core getting ready to go out. To sea, and so it's a research cruise, but I usually shorten it, you know, say to my family or my colleagues, I'm going on a cruise. And my colleagues, they get it, but I think most of my family, they envision me out on the princess whatever vessel doing yoga at noon and maybe shuffleboard. Trust me, it's nothing like this, even though we do call it a cruise. Most of our research is in close coordination with NOAA. So we use their vessels. We usually sleep in bunk beds. We don't hot bunk, but we have usually about 4 beds to a room. And we have to do a lot of safety measures. So you see me up in the Gumby suit. So we have to do, you know, man overboard drills and so forth. It's fun, but it is a lot of hard work. We work 24-hour days because a day, I think, on one of these vessels is a couple $1,000. So we don't want to waste any minute of it. So you can either have the night shift or the day shift. So one of our cruises, just to kind of do the numbers, we did 12 ROV dives, you know, tons of DVD videos of all those dives that we took. Let's see here, 32 box cores, 34 push cores, 20 mono cores, over 1,000 pounds of mud, and we also recovered some landers, and I'll show you some pictures of those. So to support all the scientists and the crew, which I guess 19 science members, 30 ship crew, and 10 ROV technicians that feed us. I guess over 100 pounds of bacon, over 2,000 eggs, and 60,000 gallons of fresh water used. So I like to say it's just another day at the office. But we've learned a tremendous amount of information. And if you just look at the number of publications in the field, it's growing exponentially. And I guess, again, this has to do with logistics. Technology is going in parallel to our science, so we can really answer a lot of these outstanding questions. And I think what's fascinating about this field, it's this wonderful confluence between biology, oceanography, geology, engineering, as well as technology. So what do we learn? One thing that we learned is that deep sea corals are worldwide. They're ubiquitous. They're not restricted to the tropical zone. So that, again, they can live in the cold waters of the fjords at shallow depths. They live in Hawaii, along the seamounts. They can live up in Alaska, all over. The things that they need to survive, again, are hard substrate. One of the reasons that they're worldwide is if you start to look at their global distribution with respect to ocean currents. Basically, the corals follow where the oceans are providing flow for their larvae to disperse. And so this is the lophelia coral that basically is pole-to-pole distribution. And you can see the red spots that where they are found basically follows the major currents of the ocean. And the way that this occurs is through the deep sea coral reproduction techniques. And so they release their larvae and they spawn. And the larvae kind of float up and get carried by the current. And then they need to find a hard substrate to settle on. So sometimes it'll be a seamount. And basically they kind of hopscotch their way and distribute globally. And you can take a close-up of their larvae and kind of imagine these small buoyant eggs floating, hopscotching their way to distribute themselves globally. Okay, so what do they need? They need cold temperatures. We typically work in degrees Celsius, and so they live in temperatures between 4 degrees and 12 degrees, and just to kind of give you a sense of what that is, I love to swim, and so for me, this is a good comparison. The pool that I swim with in Menlo Park is about 27 degrees. So these are another way to view these as cold water corals. Again, they need something hard to settle on, so something we call a substrate. And they need flow of water. And the reason they need flow of water is, remember, they're sessile organisms. They can't move around and go get their lunch. So their lunch has to be brought to them. So they need flow of water to deliver their food. And some of these organisms actually feed on food that is made up in the photic zone. So that's photosynthetically fixed and gets transported down to the surface. So even though these corals are living at a couple hundreds to thousands of meters, they're actually linked to the food production at the surface ocean. So for me, I think that's really exciting to make that link. And they're very old. The oldest tree, I believe, is the bristlecone, and it's been dated about 5,000 years. Well, the deep sea corals that we've dated in Hawaii have been dated over 4,000 years old. So it's the oldest living organism in the ocean. And again, I just draw your attention to these skeletons. There's so many analogies to trees. They look like a bush, they look like a tree, and they're extremely long-lived. So this picture is a thin section of a coral skeleton compared to a tree. And unlike shallow corals that can grow by layers, kind of linearly, these corals actually have radial growth, just like a tree. So if you were to look at the, here's a good example, if you look at the bottom of one of these coral skeletons, you'll see that there's rings. And so you can actually make a very thin cut and look at this with a scanning electron micro, and you can count the layers. And what we found is that these organisms are extremely slow growing. So the black coral, which is the one I just showed you, its growth rate, so how much it grows per year, is between 8 to 10 microns per year. Let's put that into perspective. Your fingernail grows over 3,000 microns per year. Shallow tropical coral will grow maybe 10 to 12 millimeters per year. And a teenage boy, about 100 millimeters per year. So it really points to the fact that these are extremely slow growing. And just like some of the old growth forests, you can imagine with extreme longevities and slow growth rates, there's heightened concern that these organisms are really vulnerable to disturbance, whether it's natural or human-induced. And this really, I think, got a lot of attention after the deep water horizon spill in 2010 in the Gulf of Mexico. So this was a huge explosion in April where the oil drilling estimated to release between 4.1 to 4.6 million barrels of oil. And research is still going on to try to understand, are the ecosystems rebounding and what sort of restoration efforts should we be doing? And the corals were not immune to this impact. This is a deep sea coral that's within 11 kilometers of the spill site. The one on the right is a picture of a healthy coral. You can see there's lots of tissue. It has these other organisms that are living on it, so it's a healthy habitat. And the picture on the other side, you can see sort of this brown flocculant, which they believe was related to the oil spill. And when these corals get stressed out, they expel their tissue. And they basically, it's kind of, the tissue sloughs off, and basically that's their death. And so very concerned about these kinds of accidents and how it's affecting these fragile ecosystems. Other threats to deep sea corals include fishing effects. Like I said, trawling is very, very detrimental to these deep sea coral ecosystems. There's harvesting of precious corals. You can imagine these, the skeleton is this is called a gold coral. Its official name is Girardi, but people make a lot of jewelry out of this. In some places, like in Hawaii, they are licensed to do this, but there's a lot of illegal harvesting of deep sea corals for the jewelry business. Oil and gas exploration and extraction can cause damage to these corals, whether through accidents or increasing sedimentation in the area, basically burying these. Mineral mining, sedimentation, even climate change. We're seeing changes in pH due to global carbon cycle, where basically these corals that calcify, any changes in pH can cause dissolution. So we imagine these are immune to what's going on the surface, but they are being affected. And also things like waste disposal and just basically pollution. When we were diving off the coast of Virginia, we saw things like refrigerator parts down. I mean, people just dump stuff in the deep sea and they figure there's nothing down there, but there's a tremendous amount of ecosystems that can be affected. So I just want to kind of wrap up and say, hopefully you now know that there's an amazing ecosystem that exists beneath the deep sea, and whether you're interested in biology, ecology, engineering, technology, there's a lot more questions to be pursued. And again, hope that the things that you take in your field or be passionate, like what you do, continue to ask questions and take chances and really embrace the change. There are opportunities out there and you may not know them, but you certainly should be open to them. So happy to answer questions, and if anyone's interested, I can tell them a little bit more about how these skeletons grow.
Has there been any research done on how to deacidify the ocean besides lowering our carbon?
In terms of deacidifying the ocean?
Yeah, like, because people talk about like iron fertilization as like one way to.
Yeah.
So is there something similar that could work?
In terms of like changing a buffering capacity,
yeah,
I don't think, I think we, the gentleman's bringing up this idea that if you increase primary productivity by feeding the ocean iron, that makes basically the photosynthetic critters really happy, and they increase their primary production and absorb more CO2. I think that was really popular, like in the 90s. And I think what we learned is that nature is very, very complex, and that we risk a lot by trying to do some of that engineering. So I have not heard anything about kind of deacidifying the ocean.
For sonar detection, how are you able to avoid errors where living things are under it? Because the computer might identify it as ground. That's not good.
Yeah, so they are able to actually, through their data processing, remove some of that. And also depends on the frequency. Because, for example, the fisheries will use, fisheries groups will use a different system if they're trying to do counts or something. And so the I don't know the ins and outs of the engineering, but they can definitely deconvolve that signal.
So you get a research project approved and you research on
it? Yeah, so it depends. If you want to take samples, you have to first make sure that they're not protected. There's something called the CITES protection. And so there's certain organisms that are under full protection, and so you can apply for permits. But in cases where they're not protected, or you're just taking water samples or rock samples, then you don't necessarily have permits or require permits. Like, for example, we would get permits through Fish and Wildlife, let's say in Hawaii.
What about like funding?
Yeah, so funding's obviously the crux of one of the issues. Our funding is all through the United States Geological Survey, so we are part of the Department of Interior, just like National Park Service, so it's where some of your tax dollars go. But we also work a lot with the National Science Foundation, as well as NOAA. And then there's also individual organizations. There's a big one that just started a few years ago called the Schmidt Ocean Institute that was started by Eric Schmidt of Google. And they have a big vessel out there. So there's a lot of interest in private foundations supporting this. Bob Ballard, he discovered the Titanic. He has a big organization out there as well. And so what's nice is I think the science community is really being open to other opportunities, not just federal funding for ships of opportunity.
So has there been any recent development or any new technology or area that has you excited?
Sorry, it has me excited?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think what I'm really excited is these instruments that can actually be deployed for long periods of time that are equipped with sensors. So for example, what we'll do is we'll send down a tripod or something called a lander. Basically, it's a metal frame that will go down, sit at the bottom of the ocean for maybe up to a year, depending on the battery life of all the sensors. And so we can understand what's going on in that environment beyond the 1 hour that we were there. And so it can collect sediment, it can make measurements of carbon, it can make measurements of pigments, and also not just collecting samples but also making measurements. So if you had a nice big instrument in your lab that some of these engineers are now building that can fit, you know, in my hand and go down at water depth. So I think it's, again, this amazing marriage. Folks at Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute and VARI have a wonderful marriage between the technology and the engineering and the scientists, again, to really downscale some of these instruments so that we can bring them you know, out to sea and leave them in the water for extended periods of time.
Materials do you use for the ROD and those other types of underwater high pressure environments like labels?
Yeah, I mean I could kind of just generally speak to it since I'm a user. But I mean it has to be a combination of withstanding pressure. So obviously they do tons of tests in water tanks to make sure that these all pressurized. All the video camera that you see are encased and are specialized. And also kind of this balance between weight as well, because they have thrusters on these ROVs, so they want to be able to manipulate and move them around. But I don't know necessarily all that. I know there's private industry that are building a lot of these ROVs, and some of these companies are here in the Bay Area.
So you're in an international water. Do you network with and you? Collaborate with other people.
Yeah, it's a really good point. For example, the last vessel that I was on had folks from the Netherlands, had folks from Germany. I've worked with the Spaniards. So definitely, there's the ocean doesn't know its boundaries. And so I think we try to embrace that too and really work across boundaries with our collaborators. Good question. So our next research cruise is in 2017, and we will be going back to these canyons off the coast of the Carolinas.
How long does your typical trip last you?
Good question. I would say at a minimum going out to sea, probably 2 weeks. The longest I was out to sea was 2 months, and that was in the Antarctic. But it really kind of depends on how far your site is and how many days you have to steam out there. Again, it's so expensive that you kind of want to just make the most of it, and so steaming in and out doesn't really make sense. So I'd say at least a few days. Again, there are opportunities for students to go out there. NOAA in particular is really supportive of that, and so I try to send some of my students out, and so there are opportunities, and I can try to compile a list of some of these for Aaron, maybe to distribute or another STEM person.
What are out in the Carolinas, what are the biggest ecological stresses for the corals there? Is it like runoff, recreational boating?
Yeah, so the biggest thing in these canyons where these deep sea corals exist is fishing. Basically, there's tons of abandoned nets. And also trash as well. And so these nets can break off the coral. These guys are fragile, so at least from my perspective, that's the number one. We did find some sort of trace metals in the sediment, but I don't think that is the primary stressor. Yeah, thanks. That's a really good question. I think the first thing is just being aware, know that these ecosystems exist, and also being a strong advocate for the research, and also being a proponent of banning trawling and dredging.
So thank you, everybody, and please thank Nancy. She's going to stay around a little bit if you have some questions.
Thank you. like me to like pick you up, or would you like me to find you?